when this whole business was first broached, you know, and I stopped thinking about it as a public embarrassment, but more as a chance to reconnect with old friends and colleagues. I thought it was great until one of the organizers, the only one that put me down in her talk, indicated that what I should really do at the end was give a precise and pristine summary of critical events in my career and how it all hung together and encapsulate everything in a few pithy words. I only began to enjoy this day when I realized I didn't actually have to do that. But I could share with you a few things that I think of as kind of milestones in my career and illustrate sort of what I think of either as principles or landmark events, not so much in terms of science, but in terms of the way I developed as a scientist. And so this begins long before I was a scientist. When I was a kid, I loved mysteries of various kinds. Listened to the radio, to programs that always had a puzzle and there was a solution. And that's something that I sort of bonded to, but didn't realize how to activate until I was a senior in college and still just sort of bumbling about, just taking exams and doing well because it was easy for me to accumulate material until finally as a senior I took an advanced course with one of Tufts University's very few genuine researchers, Kenneth Roeder, who taught a course in advanced physiology. And it was suddenly at that moment that I realized that there were questions out there about biology for which the answers were not known and for which mechanisms were not understood, and that was a career that offered me the chance of addressing mysteries for the rest of my life in this kind of magical world. And so to the late Dr. Roeder, I really owe a tremendous amount of gratitude because it was the first step that steered me sort of away from just following what everybody else was doing and go off to medical school. Although I did that, I did it now with a fresh idea that what I really wanted to do was train myself for a career in research. And I did that. Went to medical school, emphasized research, got a PhD, went back and realized that medicine was really not for me, and set out for a career in research. And had a wonderful time at the beginning, except that I also learned that research life was incredibly repetitious. And I struggled with that. And was complaining to a fellow postdoc, I think, at the time, about this. And he had the wisdom to point out that this was a job like any job. And I think, as Don Cort has written in the little book of mementos, I was always a sports fan. And so it became clear that this job, doing science, was like any job. And even if I was a ball player, I'd have to go to bat, you know, thousands and thousands of times. Each of them was a small assay. And who was I to complain about doing yet one more when Henry Aaron had already done 12,000? So I accepted the notion that this was not only going to be great fun, but was also going to be a job and one that one had to stick with. And the other direction that I see as I look back at my career that I learned early on also came from another sports figure, and that's the notion that each of those jobs had to be done with a lot of focus. And there the great hero was Cal Ripken, the great Baltimore Oriole, who, despite the fact that he was superb at many things, was often seen before games working on stuff that he felt were things he didn't do very well. And that insight has stood me well all these years. And in fact, in many ways, the rubber tubing that Kiyoshi gave me was part of that, of working on things that I didn't do well. When I was a kid and would take all sorts of aptitude tests, the one part that I always did poorly on was, in fact, sort of spatial recognition, where they showed you a bunch of blocks and you could not see the full pattern and you had to deduce what was behind the wall and so on. That's something that didn't come naturally to me. And yet in the middle of my career, I found myself faced with problems in topology, and I invented as many toys and tools as I can to work on what I didn't do very well, and it sort of helped me over the rough spots. So I started this career with a sense of, yes, I wanted to work hard and I wanted to be very focused, but it was really one of the early experiences that also gave me the mantra of what it was I wanted to do. And actually, Dan Campbell's talk today just reemphasized that. Many of you don't know that when I came to the NIH, it was not to work on phage lambda. I didn't even know about phage lambda at the time. It was to work on quantum chemistry and to use theoretical physical chemistry to calculate properties of biological molecules. This was a result of my realization that not only was I not going to be well-suited for medicine, I wasn't really going to be very well-suited for experimental physiology because I had lousy hands and I couldn't build amplifiers from scratch. And so I needed to do something else, and I thought, I will solve biological problems with pure theory. And so I ended up going to a physical chemistry lab, and there they did very advanced quantum mechanical calculations on biological molecules. And this is back in the early days when this had to be done by computer, of course, but it was with punch cards, I would stand there for hours hand-feeding punch cards in, and it meant writing in a Fortran language. And so early on, long before laptops and other things became popular in the lab, I was doing a lot of computer work. And it was, in fact, this training really became the mantra of my career, because the most Fortran programs were comprised of little logical blocks. And the most critical one was the if-then command. That is, if you make a hypothesis and the answer comes out one way, you do something number one, and if it comes out a different way, you do the else block. This clarified for me why it was that I was so confused in graduate school, because I didn't really have a real working sense of the distinction between gathering data and sort of asking questions. And pulling away from experimental work and doing purely computational work finally clarified that for me, and it became, as I said, sort of the tool that I had for the rest of my career, of thinking back to, well, maybe this is just like a computer program. We're going to ask, if we think this is true, what then? Just exactly the way Dan said. So he must have picked that up quite presciently from me. So, the other aspects that I found in building my career was also learning how to balance the psychological needs of this business. I'm sure you all know, science is a tough business, and even if you are committed to work hard, and even if you sort of have some greater view of hypothesis, still a lot of bad stuff happens. And I turn out to be the kind of person for whom the second half of that phrase usually overemphasizes more than the first half. So those of you who don't know, this is a line out of a musical called The Producers. It was sung often to a Brahms Hungarian dance, but it epitomized my view of things, which was that One plans, one expects most of the time that there'll be failures, partly because you're taking big steps, partly because you don't know where you're going. But it's important then, if you're going to expect failure, to have that failure teach you something. And I realized only many years later that, in fact, this was something that the psychologists actually had identified as one way that certain kinds of people deal with anxiety. They pointed out that most Americans are basically Norman Vincent Peale optimists. They are able to move forward because they're bright, positive people who think that everything is going to work. Those of us who aren't gifted in that way have learned to be defensive pessimists, that is, expecting that it's going to rain and therefore carry an umbrella. That way, you're sort of covered. And a lot of the way, if you look at my career, the way I see that I've constructed things was suspecting that something wouldn't work, but hoping that I would have included enough controls or enough richness to learn something even from those failures. And so I have certainly benefited from this kind of defensive pessimism, where you can be a pessimist as long as it doesn't paralyze you, and as long as you can activate something that helps you deal with the possibility. And so it seems to me, as I look back, those are the tools that I brought to this game. And the rest, it seems to me, sort of falls out naturally, but also expresses something that's very personal. And for me, that also symbolizes the way I've felt. I'm somebody who needs to do something different at reasonable intervals. If you look at my career, it has, in fact, shifted from quantum chemistry to phage lambda biochemistry, from phage lambda biochemistry to yeast cell biology and genetics and the evaluation of an enzyme that didn't get discussed today but is still very close to my heart, the TDP enzyme, also not a very sexy name, Ulrike, I'm sorry. But the idea of being able to gratify my need to move on from a problem and to try something completely different, not something slightly different with a different wrinkle, but just to sort of break new ground, it was, for me, psychologically important, and it's one thing that I owe a tremendous debt of gratitude to the NIH and specifically to the NIMH for having a structure that has made it possible for me to reinvent myself several times in my career and therefore keep alive the spark of enthusiasm and mystery and a learning curve that keeps me going every day. Without that possibility, I'm sure one wouldn't be numbering my length of time in the organization in scores of years. So those are basically the things that have gotten me to where I am today. And it's only been in the last few years, I'm sure most of you know, that I've been struggling with a significant illness during that time, that I've done some sort of introspection tried to look at my career and learn something from it. Some of what I've told you today has some of that. But perhaps the most important lesson that I've learned is that it's really that I really had misconstrued what has given me satisfaction. I'd always imagined as I was doing it that it was the scientific progress that would give me the most satisfaction, that it was the publications, if you will, that I would be able to look back at and say, ah, yes, those were the good days, that was a great job. But in fact, as I look back, it's not so much the papers, it's the people that I find having most satisfied, and why this gathering today has been so rewarding and so positive for me, is I've come to realize that although I always thought of myself as a loner and not very people-centric, the fact it's the people that I've influenced and can see some of that transition that has tremendously made me feel this has been a worthwhile exercise to watch someone like Dan Campbell, who came in as a fresh college boy, to come back as now one of the leading lights in the field, I think is just extraordinary. This was a picture more or less taken because it's the first I could find, but it also epitomizes that. Here's Deva Smita Alone, a recent fellow who I'm just delighted, unfortunately, who couldn't be here because of visa issues, but who I'm delighted to find landed a job in India and is now in the first stages of her career. And when she does get her visa, she will come and spend a few weeks in the lab to try to generate some data to get her first grant support for her project. And Jason Rodriguez, who is here today, a fairly recent postdoc, who I remember so vividly coming back a couple of years after he left the lab to talk about his graduate school student project. And again, the wonderful sense of, gee, here's a guy who came in basically not knowing anything about science, and after a year in my lab and then a couple in graduate school, he's come back as a really mature, not fully formed, but at least well-developed person. This story, scientist. This story could be repeated dozens of times. This was the only picture that I could find, but we could go over it again and again. And then the final thing that I want to say on my last slide is something that I think I've been aware of for a long time, and that has to do with the difference between entitlement and gratitude. As my career started to develop and I had some success, the people of my parents' generation, my parents, of course, would always boast about how I was doing this and how I was doing that, and they would hand out reprints of my papers at the poolside and so on. And the answer from their generation was always, well, of course he should do this. He deserves it. He's entitled to it. And somehow that never resonated with me. I never felt that I deserved the support that I had, either from the Institute or from the people who've worked with me or from my colleagues. I've always felt that this was that each of these was a great gift. And so I want to end with a sentiment best expressed by my 8-year-old grandson, Theo Halligan, which is basically a note to tell all of you, everyone in this room, because you all encompass all the pieces that I'm grateful for. Thank you very much.